Game of Thrones, yeah! Is it time for season 3 yet? Pumped!
Almost, robot. Calm down.
Pumped.
You're gonna poke your eye out with that sword, I think, just so be careful, okay?
Oh, nuts.
What's wrong, robot?
I just got too excited for Game of Thrones and I blew a fuse! I've forgotten everything that happened in season 1 and 2, oh no!
Really? Can't remember anything.
Look at all these people. Who's that guy? I don't know. Game of Thrones is so complicated, I've exceeded my memory bandwidth allocation.
Don't worry, robot. It's gonna be okay. Not only will I update your memory banks with all the pivotal characters and families of Westeros, but I'm gonna go the extra mile and give you all the history that's missing from the show. I'm gonna give you a full history of the Targaryens. We're gonna talk about the Lannisters, the Starks, and more. So you and you will be ready for Game of Thrones Season 3. Okay, so let's start with the Targaryens. I know you know about Daenerys and Viserys Targaryen from the show. But do you know the whole story of the Targaryen family? I think not. There's generations upon generations of crazy shit going on within this crazy friggin' family. I'm gonna tell you how they rose to power over the Seven Kingdoms, how they ruled Westeros through the greatest dynasty the Seven Kingdoms has ever seen, how they eventually fell from power, and how that led up to the events of Game of Thrones Season 1.
Okay. All right, I'm on board now.
The thing is, a lot of viewers of the show don't know about the rich, complex prehistory of this world. It extends back 12,500 years. There's so much to talk about. They don't talk about it in the show as much. They touch on it, but they can't really go into detail like they do in the books. And I'm gonna give you a little bit at a time as we go on through the series.
Songs and histories from the Seven Kingdoms.
So when Game of Thrones starts, we're in 298 AL. Now AL stands for After Aegon's Landing. Now that's how crazy and significant the Targaryens are, because they have measurements of time named after them. Now in this day and age, a lot of people don't really believe in magic anymore because it's been gone for so long. Like White Walkers came around 8,000 years ago or something. So people just think that's kind of like a fairy tale at this point.
Grumpkins and Snarks and all the other monsters your wetness warned you about. You're a smart boy. You don't believe that nonsense.
Some people don't even believe the dragons ever existed, okay? They're just like, what? I don't know. I fish all day. I have no idea what a dragon is. I don't care. So if you want to know more about the Targaryens, you have to start with where they came from originally, Valyria. Now, Valyria isn't even around anymore. It used to be this peninsula extending off the coast of Essos. So back in the day, there's all these Valyrian people with white hair and purple eyes, and they had all this magic going on. Like, I don't know what was going on in Valyria, but I do know there was a lot of crazy-ass magic going on that's still unexplained to this day. Valyria was this old magical island where they made all this crazy Valyrian steel that was like infused with magic and sorcery and spells. Like a lot of the great houses, including the Starks, have a sword made of Valyrian steel that they pass down generation to generation, okay? And they don't know how to make this shit anymore, okay?
Valyrian steel.
Like nobody knows how to make it.
This is Valyrian steel.
So the Valyrians were the first people to discover dragons. There was all these dragons lairing in the 14 fires of Valyria. They found the dragons, they tamed them through their crazy weird magic, started riding them around, and then started kicking everyone's ass with them.
For dragons are fire made flesh, and fire is power.
So one day, one of the Targaryen girls has this vision where she sees this destruction come upon Valyria. She tells her dad, he believes her. So the Targaryens decide to move from Valyria. They annex Dragonstone Island off the coast of Westeros, set up camp there, and then 100 years later, the prophecy comes true, the doom of Valyria comes down, the 14 fires, the volcanoes explode all over the place, killing all the other Valyrians, all the other noble houses, and all the other dragons. The Targaryens are now the last Valyrian noble house with the last dragons. So generations later, after they set up camp on Dragonstone, this one Targaryen, Aegon, decides that he just wants to fucking conquer all of Westeros. So he gets his two sister wives, Rhaenys and Visenya, okay? And the Targaryens marry brother to sister, like uncle to niece. It's really weird. It's a Valyrian thing. The Targaryens are inbred. That's why some of them go crazy, okay? Side note. So Aegon and his two sister wives, Rhaenys and Visenya, get on their dragons, they fly over to Westeros, and they kick everyone's ass and make six of the Seven Kingdoms bend the knee. During one particular event known as the Field of Fire, 4,000 men are burned alive by dragon fire. Everyone's like slaughtered, so Aegon the Conqueror becomes the first king of Westeros. And then they rule for 300 years unbroken.
The brave men rode them. Rode them from Valyria to build the greatest civilization this world has ever seen.
The reason that the dragon has three heads on the sigil is to symbolize Aegon and his two sister wives. So I know that you've heard that the Iron Throne was forged by dragonfire, and I'm gonna tell you how that happened. So when Aegon the Conqueror came over and he conquered all the kingdoms, he took like over 1,000 swords from all the people that he conquered, and then he had it forged into the Iron Throne with the dragon fire of Valyrian the Black Dread, the dragon that he fucking rode around on. And he made it really uncomfortable because he thought that no king should ever sit easy. And kings are always cutting themselves in this fucking thing because it's literally forged out of real fucking swords with points and blades.
Say what you will about the Targaryens, they were conquerors. That is a seat for a conqueror.
Fast forward the Targaryen bloodline 300 years and you get Mad Aerys Targaryen, the last of the Targaryen kings of Westeros. He was totally nuts. He couldn't get a boner without watching someone burn alive. He was like totally pulling the Howard Hughes thing with the fingernails and the paranoia. Now he had three kids with his sister, Rhaegar, Viserys, and Daenerys. Now Rhaegar, the eldest, was totally beloved. He was super handsome. Everyone thought he was awesome. They were excited about him being the king. But then Rhaegar done fucked up when he absconded with Lyanna Stark, totally fell in love with her and kidnapped her, which sparked Robert's rebellion because Robert was betrothed to Lyanna. So Robert kills Rhaegar on the Trident, smashes the royal troops, which leads up to Jaime Lannister's decision to put a sword through his own king, even though he is a Kingsguard member, okay? You're supposed to protect the king, not kill the motherfucking king. He's like, you know what? Screw it. These guys are going down right now anyways. Puts a sword through him, puts him out of his misery. Everyone's relieved, even though everyone gives shit to Jaime about it, but whatever. That's coming up later. So Viserys and Daenerys are the last two Targaryens left, and they are whisked across the Narrow Sea as children to escape so they are not murdered like all the other Targaryens. So then Viserys and Daenerys are totally on their own. They stay at this mansion with a red door for a while until their benefactor dies in their shootout. Then they have to go from city to city. Viserys has to beg people to take them in. He's known as the Beggar King. He gets really fucking bitter about it after a while. He falls in with this merchant Illyrio who helps him sell his sister to a Dothraki horse lord so he can get some troops, some Dothraki horse lord troops.
Drogo.
I give him a queen and he gives me an army.
I don't want to be his queen.
So he can hopefully gain some Dothraki troops so he can go across the Narrow Sea and take back his motherfucking throne because he is entitled and he believes that that is his throne because technically, if you went through births, then yeah, it would be his throne.
So he does have a right to the throne.
I've waited 17 years to get my throne back.
So he does have somewhat of a legitimate claim to the throne even though he doesn't have anything to back it up with.
We go home with an army, with Khal Drogo's army. I would let his whole tribe fuck you.
What a jerk.
So then, him and Daenerys are with this Khalasar, and his sister Daenerys goes from being this docile little, like, slave of his to becoming a motherfucking queen and, like, boning Khal Drogo on a regular basis, and that will change a woman, and it did. She got Prego with Khal Drogo's baby. It's supposed to be, like, the fucking stallion that mounts the world. It's gonna take over. It's gonna be, his name's gonna be Rhaego. They're totally fucking excited about it.
She truly is a queen today.
Then Viserys gets all jelly and he's like, all these people love her and they don't love me.
I'm the last hope of a dynasty, Mormont. The greatest dynasty this world has ever seen on my shoulders since I was 5 years old. And no one has ever given me what they gave to her in that tent.
So he like comes at her and her unborn baby with a sword. Khal Drogo ain't having none of that. Fucking melts some gold, puts it on his fucking head and kills Viserys.
Daddy, please!
A crown for king.
Giving him the crown of gold that he always wanted, okay? It's totally gnarly.
Oh,
Oh, I remember that part.
And then Daenerys and Khal Drogo are having a fucking great time. Their life is a bowl of cherries. She's pregnant. They're gonna have a crazy son. Everything's good. But then, things take a turn for the worse during a routine rape and pillage by the Dothraki. Khal Drogo ends up getting his nipple cut off and it totally gets infected. Dany then attempts to save his life by getting the witch she saved from being raped to perform blood magic on him.
Only death pays for life.
The witch totally deceives her and sacrifices her unborn son. Khal Drogo lives but is left in a catatonic state and has to be mercy killed with a pillow. So then Dany is super pissed, burns the witch who fucked her over in Drogo's funeral pyre, along with her petrified dragon eggs that she got as a wedding present. But guess what? Some crazy shit went down, and then after the fire burns out in the morning, Dany is still there, unscathed, not dead, and she's got three motherfucking dragons.
That was the coolest thing that ever happened in my life.
Moving on to season two, Daenerys is totally stuck with what's left of her Khalasar in the Red Waste. It's like this fucked up desert. She sends these riders out after her core silver dies. I'm like, we gotta find some shit now. You go north, west, east, whatever. Let's figure it out. One guy comes back, head's been cut off. Another Khalasar got him. Then somebody else comes back with an invitation from the merchant port city of Karth. So they're like, well, let's go to Karth because there's water over there. So they go over there, they get there, and then these 13 assholes come out and they're all like, can I see your dragons? Because we're not gonna let you in until we see your dragons. She's like, fuck you, let me in, and then I'll show you the dragons. So then it looks like it's gonna be a stalemate. Then this one guy, Zoro's on docks, is one of the 13, like cuts his hand. He's like, hey man, I vouch for this bitch. She can come inside. So they're like, fine, we'll let her inside. She comes inside. Zoro's on Doxus wines and dines or tries to get her hand in marriage. She's like, ah, I'm not interested, thanks, but no thanks. Give me some ships, but I don't want to marry you. And he's like, eh, whatever. She goes to all the other merchants in the city, is like, give me some ships. And then everyone's like, fuck off.
I am Daenerys Stormborn of the blood of old Valyria, and I will take what is mine. With fire and blood, I will take it.
Yes, my lady, but not with my ships.
So she goes back to Zoro's place after she's done some dickering with some fucking spice merchant. She sees that all her people have been killed. She sees that her dragons are missing and she's like freaking out. She's like, where the fuck are my dragons? So anyway, Zoro's like, well, we gotta do this meeting with the 13 and maybe they can help you out. So then she goes to this meeting, but then at the meeting, Zoro and Pyat Pree, the fucked up warlock guy, they end up killing all the other 13 and they're like, we're totally gonna take this city for ourselves, and we have your dragons, and if you want them back, you need to come to the Warlock House, the House of the Undying.
Come see them.
So Dany's talking to Jorah, and she's like, oh my god, I gotta go to this friggin' crazy House of the Undying, and he's like, don't do it, man, it's a total trap, and she's like, I don't give a shit, I gotta go get my babies back. So she goes there, she somehow makes it inside this weird tower with no door, she sees all these weird visions, and then at the end, she comes face to face with the Warlock Pyat Pree, and he's like, you know what? I'm gonna trap your dragons here because they totally boost my magic abilities because dragons totally boost magic abilities and I'm gonna keep you chained here and fuck you, there's nothing you can do about it. So then she tells him, no bitch, no. She gets her dragons to roast this asshole and like fire doesn't hurt her obviously at this point. So he gets burned alive, she gets out, she's got her dragons, she goes back to Zaro's house, finds him in bed with one of her handmaidens and they're like plotting against her. She's like, fuck both of you. You're going into the vault and I'm gonna lock your asses in there. And she does, ransacks that guy's place so she can go buy ships so she can go do a lot of fucking conquering in season three.
Oh, snap. Wow, I remember it all now.
Daenerys has one of my favorite storylines. She's definitely obviously a fan favorite. She's one of my favorites. But I just really love how George R.R. Martin like knows how to write a strong female character and like take her from like nothing to just like greatness. And I love seeing it unfold.
But you left out one thing.
What's that, robot?
What's the deal with Jorah Mormont? And is he ever gonna tap that ass?
I'm not gonna tell you whether he is or isn't. Or is, because that would be a major spoiler. But let's talk about Jorah Mormont In 60 seconds.
Go.
So Jorah Mormont is from the Mormont family from Bear Island in Westeros, which is a vassal of Eddard Stark. They're from the north. So his dad abdicated his seat to go join the Night's Watch, who has become the commander of the Night's Watch as of right now. So Jorah's wife is a crazy bitch. She's a money-hungry hoe. She's like, gotta have that nice stuff. He doesn't have any money. So he resorts to selling poachers to slavers.
What does that mean? What's a poacher to a slaver?
He will find people who are illegally hunting on Bear Island.
Oh, they were hunting bears?
Well, I don't know what they were hunting, but whatever
probably
it was.
Probably bears.
I hate you. You're never gonna get it.
Maybe it was gophers.
You're never gonna understand Game of Thrones at this point.
Now Ned Stark wants my head. He drove me from my land.
Ned Stark was coming to cut his head off for it, so he and his wife fled across the Narrow Sea to the Free City, so he's living in exile out there. His wife left him, and she's some concubine to some merchant now. So while he's roaming around the Free City, somehow he gets hooked up with King Robert and becoming a spy for him, hopefully so he can get back to Westeros and get a royal pardon. So he's spying on Dany, he's keeping King Robert informed as to what's going on. But eventually, Dany ends up winning him over, and he has all these unrequited feelings towards her, and he ends up following her for real, but she doesn't know that he totally has a royal pardon and he could go back to Westeros right now if he wanted to, but he doesn't want to because he loves her.
Someone who can rule and should rule centuries come and go without a person like that coming into the world. There are times when I look at you and I still can't believe you're real.
She should give it up because she would be nowhere if it wasn't for him.
Jorah's been absolutely critical for Dany to have achieved what she's achieved. Like the fact that like they met and he's helped her has really helped solidify her as a leader. And not only is he sexually attracted to her, but he really does love her like in his little heart because like he wants to see her do well. It's not just lust here, okay? He really does care about her a lot.
What a guy. Great guy.
What a cutie. Hot piece of old man ass. And next up on Mastering Game of Thrones, I'm gonna tell you all about the sordid history of my favorite house, the Lannisters. I'm gonna give you a bunch of stuff that isn't in the show yet, but you totally need to know and it'll enrich your experience. Like for example, did you know that Tywin Lannister used to be the Hand of the King for Mad King Aerys?
Drogo! Go, Khal Drogo! I hope Khal Drogo wins the Iron Throne! Yeah! He's my favorite.
Robot, he's dead.
He's macho like me.